Hello, good morning. How's everybody? Please let me know if you are able to properly hear and see my screen. I hope that everybody was able to stay healthy and that you are able to properly see and hear me. I will wait a couple of seconds. Okay, so I have some confirmation here from Twitch. I hope that someone from YouTube will confirm as well. So thank you for that. Hi, Horatio, good morning. Okay, so we are able to properly receive the input. So today we are discussing about some options on securing our mobile applications, and also about what the framework, the Android framework, is providing for us in terms of security. Google, part of the security alliance with all the other vendors, is pushing some on multiple fronts some security measures. And the main one is Google Play Protect. So maybe you already noticed on all mobile devices that are supported by Google, we have that Google Play application from where we are downloading the apps. But also that's the app that is ensuring that the device is meeting the security constraints that Google is enforcing for all the vendors. And here for we have three main ways on which Google is ensuring that we have a secure device. So one being at the application level, the Google Play Protect. Another one is at the platform level. So here we will see in a minute how using all sorts of measurements, they are ensuring that the vendors are obeying the security constraints, and also a development lifecycle where with bug fixes and updates they are protecting us from all sorts of malwares and unwanted behavior. So we will take a look on each of those. Google Play Protect, as we said, it's part of the operating system. If your mobile development device is enabled by Google, so it's supported by Google services, and that application, the Play Protect, maybe you noticed when you are trying to install something, it will present us a report with the number of security issues that were found on our app. And it's running always on the device, so it's a background service that's always scanning. And Google is reporting right now that each day over 100 billion apps are scanned. So quite a big number. Another security feature that maybe some of you are not aware that it's still part of Google Play Protect is that Find My Phone functionality. So if you are enabling it in the settings from any browser that's connected to your Google account or the same account that you use to register the device, you will be able to perform a query like Find My Phone, and that will trigger a call on the device. This one, probably it's something that you already experienced. Part of the same Google Play Protect is the service that's available in the Chrome browser that is ensuring that we are not, as users, accessing websites that are having some malware or some issues, mainly certificates. So probably you saw this with HTTP certificates. But it's more than that. So if you'd like to see all the features that the security features that Google Play Protect is enforcing, you can check the link below. Like I said, another line, protection line, is at the platform level. And here, because the Android operating system is using Linux behind the scenes, we can benefit as a platform from all the security work that was done on Unix and Linux. And by default, Android is using Selinux. Maybe some of the users that are using Linux already heard about it. It's a service that a kernel module that's allowing administrators to create sandboxes and also to have a more granular access control for per user even. So if we remember from our operating system classes, Unix operating systems by default are enforcing security constraints at the user and group and for the rest of the users levels per file. Here with Selinux, we can control per user even, so we can add more control there. Another security feature that's available in the Linux kernel is the control flow integrity, and here we are dealing more with the security concerns at the execution level. So when a process is trying to allocate or run certain code in memory buffer, so the control flow integrity will ensure that we are not having buffer overflow issues and security issues around the executions path. And the last part of the platform methods is the verify boot. And here, probably you saw this if you tried to install applications from outside the Google Play Store. So in order to install something on our device that's not received from the Play Store, we need to turn off a check in the settings, and that check will bypass the verify boot. So the verify boot module is ensuring that whenever we are installing something from Play Store, that those binaries, the APK, the Android package, is properly signed, and the author of the package is the one that is supposed to be, and the package, the signature of the package, is the one from the store. So please pay attention, especially if you are trying to install packages from outside the store, that you can verify that those binaries are from the source that you are trying, or the vendor, or the author that is pushing them. Because if you are registering something on your device, it may harm the system as well. As the development life cycle, maybe you heard about Project Tremble. So before the Project Tremble in Android, the release, so one operating release, was embedding also the vendor driver. So for a phone, if let's say we have a phone from Nokia or from HTC, in order to release an Android version, so let's say Android 11 on their device, or Android 8, let's say before Project Tremble, they had to update the operating system to use their own vendor drivers for camera, for Bluetooth, let's say, for all the hardware devices that they are using on that specific device. And whenever Google, let's say, was pushing another update for that operating system, the vendor had to rebuild everything and to ensure that the new API is working with their drivers. And that was taking a lot of time, and for that reason a lot of vendors were not providing updates with the latest versions of Android framework, because they were not able to allocate time and resources to maintain all those updates. And the users were disappointed from the point of view of security concerns. They were still running older code that was having potential issues. With Project Tremble, as we can see on the diagram, the operating system abstracted the interface with the vendor, and they created an interface named HAL, so Hardware Access Layer, where the operating system is decoupled from the vendor implementations. So theoretically, and we already saw this from Android 10, Google is able to push their updates and still use the old vendor implementation. So a vendor like Samsung, let's say, in order to update their devices to the latest Android OS, they only need to apply their UI, let's say, customizations, the drivers and the hardware communication is already the same. So the operating system is decoupled from the hardware layer. So by using this approach, and maybe you already saw the announcements, so from Android 10, Google is enforcing all the vendors to implement the Tremble project. So you are not able to release a phone with Google certifying that device if you are not supporting Project Tremble anymore. From our point of view as developers, we need also to ensure that our users' data is secure. So by default, all the applications are running in the sandbox and everything is encrypted on the device regarding to the application content. But whenever we are exchanging information with servers that are outside of, let's say, our mobile development device or our mobile device, so if we are connecting to a third-party server, that communication should be encrypted. If we are not encrypting it, then all sorts of security issues that maybe you discussed already at the networking classes can arise. Also, if we are storing user sensitive data, we need to ensure that if someone is, let's say, re-engineering our app or is trying to dig the content of our user database, they will fail. And also, whenever we are accessing critical information from the device related to the user, we need to obey certain permissions. And part of the Google Play Protect, we have some guidelines, and they are saying that we should minimize the API access regarding the sensitive data for the user. So we shouldn't ask for permissions or try to access user information if the user is not requesting it. Also, whenever we are saving data related to user identity, we should use hashes instead of saving their phone, let's say, in clear text, or their full name in clear text. If we need that information to match, let's say, if a user is in the same group with another user, or if let's say we would like to establish an exchange of information between some users, we don't need their real biometrics or, let's say, identity details like social security numbers or phone details or real contact data information. We only need some hash data that's representing that real information. And based on those hash messages, we will be able to detect if some of the users know each other, let's say, or they already have some services enabled that that we need. So when we are building, let's say, a chat app, in order to detect if other contacts from our mobile contacts are having the application installed, we can hash all of them and send the hashed information to the server, let's say, to check if other contacts from the servers are using or are available on the system. So that's also improving, let's say, the security, but also the marshaled content. So instead of sending full text and a bunch of it with phones and social security numbers and full names, we will send only a hash, which is an integer value, let's say, and or an MD5 or a SHA number that will be much, much smaller than the real data. Also, we need to pay attention if we are storing or persisting user sensitive data on our devices. Like we said, we have multiple options. One of them are settings, another one is the internal storage, the external storage, content providers, and databases. So we should not use the word readable on and word readable permissions when we are storing sensitive data. Okay, so if we are using the shared locations, we should not use at least those permissions. We should not store sensitive data on external storage, because like we said when we discussed about the external storage, that's on an SD card. And the user is able to remove the SD card and to install it in another device, like a development machine or a desktop computer, where they will, with their own operating system, will be able to gain access to the clear data on that external storage. So imagine if you are building a banking app or a game, and you are storing some sensitive data on that external storage, the user, with the help of another machine, will be able to access all those files and to update them. And suddenly they will gain a lot of, let's say, money or, I don't know, score on a game, something like that. And here we need to pay attention. Even let's say if we as an application, we are not storing the data on an external storage, the user from settings may opt out for our application to be moved to the external storage. And this is happening on frequently on mobile devices where we are low on space. So the users will be able, if they have an SD card, will be able to move certain applications to be persistent on the external storage. And we are losing suddenly all the protections from the internal storage when the application is moved on the external storage. So we should pay attention and we should deal with it. We should encrypt, or we should ensure that sensitive data will not be left unprotected on the external storage. What they are advising us is to always, if possible, use the internal storage or content providers or DB engines, and there to encrypt or at least obfuscate the sensitive data. Maybe some of you already know this. In Java, there is a security package where we can perform all sorts of security encryptions, and the popular one is using a private and a public key with a certificate. And if you will check the details on the crypto specs, you'll see all of those. So maybe you already are aware of those, so they can be used in Android as well, and we will take a look in a couple of seconds on how to use them. Another measure that we can ensure that not authorized user is not allowed to access the content of our application is to enforce a lock screen on the device. And here we can see how easy we can check if the device is secure. So device is secure in this context means that it has a lock screen. And here we can see what are the variations between before Marshmallow release, so Android M, and after that. So before Marshmallow release, from the keyboard manager, we were querying a property name is guard secure. From Marshmallow going further, we are using, so it's not part of the guard service anymore, so we have a specialized method named is device secure. And here you can see how we are leveraging the build versions to be able to detect if we are running on a device that's older than Marshmallow or newer than Marshmallow. And the keyboard manager is obtained from the context, so in all our activities, application or fragments, we will be able to perform the get system service call with the guard service as an argument. Okay, so this will ensure that we can detect if our device is having a lock screen or not. And we can do much more than that, so we can use that information on our startup of our application. So we can present an alert dialog, so on start, if the device is not secure, we can pop up the user with a message like this, so and guide him to settings where to enable the lock screen. And here you can see how easier they made it for us to from the context to call the open lock settings screen, so that will move us directly to the settings screen. If not, so if the user will press the negative button, so in this case the exit button, we can exit the process altogether, so that system exit will exit the application suddenly. Okay, and we have an option here with set cancelable, and that's taking a boolean, and in this case we can use the buildconfig.debug boolean that will allow us to have a third button only if we are running in debug, and we can cancel this lock screen and move further. So this will be, let's say, a good option to have if while in development we don't care about that protection to be able to test a certain screen. We will enable the cancel button, and we will be able to test automatically the screens, let's say the UI interaction, without having a lock screen on the device. So if we are choosing to encrypt data using the Java framework that's available, maybe you recognize what we are presenting here. So we can use the key store, and from the key store to get the key pairs. So we can see how we can generate an RSA key pair. And again, here we have some variations. Before Marshmallow, we were doing a certain call. After Marshmallow, we are performing another one. The difference is that from Marshmallow, they started, Google, with their certification process, started to enforce using better security chips. And we have access to more security features on those devices, and that's why we have those different implementations. So we are specifying a key when we are on the name of the store. Here the Android Key Store is something that we can set, so we can create our own store, we can use the default one. So here we are using the Android Key Store. Like I said, the algorithm here is use RSA, and when we are initializing, let's say, in something on an operating system that's greater than Marshmallow, we will do something like this. So we are using the keygen parameters packs with a builder. We can specify the purpose for what we would like to use the keys. So we can specify that we would like to use them only for encryption or only for decryption, because they are using a private and a public key. Here it matters. So if we would like to encrypt the data, we will use the public key of the destination recipient, and if we would like to decrypt, let's say, our own received information that was encrypted with our public key, we will use the private key to decrypt the message. Or we can use both of them, like in this sample with an OR statement, and then we can both encrypt and decrypt the information. And we are setting some block modes here and padding property, and after that we can initialize the keys. We can also manage them, so we can use to retrieve directly the private key, the public key, and we can register them to the store or to remove them from the store. Once we have them, we can create helper functions like this, an encrypt and decrypt, with the help of a cipher. By specifying a transformation, we will be able to encrypt or decrypt the message that we receive. As algorithms, we have available a bunch here, but please know that only starting with API 18, we have access to those two. So before API 18, we didn't have any algorithms available, and the rest of them are available only from API 23. Okay, so if we have devices that are having API lower than 18, then we are not able to properly encrypt using an algorithm that that's presented here, because it's not available on those devices. And here you can try this even on a desktop Java application, so you can use the Java security package and encrypt a message like this, a hello world message. So we are retrieving a reference to the store, then we are creating our keys from a master key, let's say, that was saved in the store, and then we are specifying a cipher, and once we properly initialize the cipher, we will be able to encrypt and decrypt with the encrypt and decrypt methods. And the message like hello world will be encoded in something like this. Okay, and if we are using decrypt with a source like the one specified here, we will get back the hello world message, as long as we are using the same security keys in the store. Part of the Jetpack, we have some results that the Jetpack team published. Right now it's still in alpha, so it's not a stable release yet, so they are changing the API, but they are advising us to migrate our security code to Jetpack Security. It's based on Think, Google Think, so that's a bigger project, a bigger security project on the Google's front, where they are trying to provide more granular security, let's say, interfaces and a unified, an abstract unified way on encrypting and decrypting information. What's available right now in Jetpack Security is focused on files and on share preferences. And they already achieved a good set of methods that can be, they are providing a good set of methods that can allow us to properly encrypt and decrypt information with good performance. And they are advertising that using this library will maximize the security for our users. To set up Jetpack Security for our app, we need that include that's presented here. And if we would like to use identity credentials, then we need the second one. As we can see, the APIs are release candidates and also alpha right now. Once we have them enabled, to read a file, we will use a similar approach to what Java security framework is presenting. So we still need access to the store, but here it's hidden for us. So by default, they are initializing the default store. We have API access and we can change the store. But in general, you'll see that most of the time we will use the default store. And using the master key builder, we will be able to request a certain scheme from the default store by specifying the algorithms here. And once we are building a key from the master key, we will be able to use the encrypt files API with its builder to specify the file location. So we are using the application context, then the actual file, and here you can see how we are using the file API to specify a directory and the file that we will, the file name that we would like to read, then the key that we just created, and then we are specifying how the encryption should be done. And once we have that, we will be able to create streams to the sorry, the encrypted file, and the middle and the lower part of the code is regular file access code, but right now we are using a stream that's able to decrypt the information for us. So in the last call, after we are receiving everything from that byte stream, we will be able to get the plain text information as bytes. To write to a file, so to encrypt information and to persist it in a file, it's something similar that we can do. So we are getting using the same process, the master key, and after that we are using the same encrypted file builder to initialize the file, and we will use the regular write calls. And here we need to ensure that we are calling the flush operation and close, because behind the scenes a buffer is used, and by default the stream, the write call is writing in the buffer, and if we are not flushing and closing the file, it may remain in the buffer, and if our application is suddenly terminated by the operating system, that information will be lost. So to ensure that the information that we would like to persist in our files even if they are plain text, not encrypted, we need to flush the content and then to close, properly close the file. And here you can see that we are using the apply keyword that's available in Kotlin to serialize a bunch of calls on the same output stream, file output stream. Okay. Like I said, the Jetpack security package is focused also on shared preferences. The shared preferences, like their name is suggesting, can be shared among applications. And if we are not encrypting them, theoretically another application may be able, that's not, let's say, an application that we would like to receive the information. Theoretically, if they know that we have shared preferences and they know the keys, can retrieve the sensitive information. And they are advising us to use the encrypt shared preferences API. And here, using the create and a similar key that we just created for files, with the same application context and the shared preference file, we will be able to encrypt the information. So with that edit call, we will be able to edit sensitive data and ensure that the information is persisted on the device. Another package that's available, part of the Jetpack security, is the biometric features. And here we can see a sample of code on how we can prompt the user to authenticate their access using their biometric data. So if your phone or mobile device is supporting face recognition or touch, so fingerprint information, those behind the scenes will be made available by the biometric service. And in our app, we will not need to be aware if they are using their face or they are using let's say the fingerprint to authenticate their access. From our point of view, we will only, let's say, request the system to trigger the biometric authentication. And this can be easily done with the biometric prompt class that they are providing. Here you can see that we are binding it to the activity. We are specifying an executor because the call is made in an async way, and we have a callback. And the callback here is providing two methods, on success and on error. And if we are landing on success, that means that the user authenticated properly with a biometric, let's say, their fingerprint. If we have an error, we can either trigger a retry or present the user a message that they failed to authenticate. And to use the biometric prompt, we can easily set up on let's say a dialogue using the prompt info builder, where we can specify a title, some description, and if we are allowing to use the device credentials. Okay, so that means that the already authenticated user will not be prompted if they unlocked the device in a short period of time. They will bypass the biometrics checks. The description in this prompt is very important, because here we need to provide all the details for the user to recognize why we need to request that authentication step. So here we will specify the reason why we need, and what will be the capability that will be unlocked by that authentication. We have a demo here. So we have actually two demos. The first one is the encryption and decryption logic provided by the file API. So in our GitHub repository, we have a project named FileLocker. And here the application, so let's start for the application. The application is only presenting a demo on how we can, I think I need to refresh a little bit the UI of the phone, because the resolution was changed. So here is an app where we are encrypting some information for the user. So we can create some entries like a to-do app-like, where we can specify a title, test, and the body of that entry will be encrypted. Okay, so if we are pressing save here, the content will be encrypted for us, and whenever we will try to enter it, the content should be decrypted. Okay, so here we have an action to set a password, and we will use test one, let's say, to set the password. And now whenever we will try to enter an entry, the password will be requested. Okay, so if we don't know the password, so, or if we are providing a wrong one, I pressed the cancel. So we will get a message that the password is incorrect. And if you will check the code from here, you'll see that the keys are stored in preferences. And whenever we are trying to access a file, we will decrypt. Or whenever we are saving something, we will encrypt the file. And here I think we have the logic that's encrypting. So here is the logic on how we are creating a new file and also updating a new file. So first we are deleting the file, and then we are using the get encrypt call to get the encrypted file, like we saw on the slides. The stream, the encrypted stream, and after that we are writing normally in that file. And to get the encrypted file, we are doing almost the same thing that was presented on the slide. So we are getting a reference to the master key using the default alias. In this case, we are specifying a scheme, an encryption scheme, and after that with the builder, with the location of the file, we are getting the access to the stream. Okay, so it's pretty easy, and we are doing the same thing when we try to read. So the file, we will get the same stream, and after that we will apply the Java API logic to retrieve the entries from the file. Okay, so I hope that's pretty easy to understand. And for the biometric demo from here, we will deploy this on a real device. Hopefully I will be able to connect the real device. So I'm connecting now a real device here, and I will deploy the app on the device. I'm using an application named Visor to be able to share the screen of the connected mobile device with you. So here we can we can see how we can authenticate us with an email and a password, or we can use the biometrics that are available. First, we will need to create a user here, and that's the validation rules are pretty simple here. We need an email like username, and then a password that's at least 5 characters. And once we are authenticated, let's say by the server, we will be able to use the fingerprint that's available on our device. So now that I authenticate, you can see that we are able to, let's say, move on with the real data on the real processes in our application. So whenever we will use from this point on the biometrics, we will only need to authenticate us, and we will be moved to the encrypted activity, let's say, logic. And here I think this is the enable biometric login activity is the first one that's available, and in this sample we are using the binding API that's available, part of the Jetpack Compose, and also a model view and the live data that we learned. So if we are using if we are checking the view model, we are implementing a pattern similar to the block one here with the live data. So we have a method named login here that will ensure that, like I said, theoretically we will connect to a server, and that server will validate our username and password or DB engine. And once we validate it, we are creating a new state here named login result with success set to true, and we will push that in a live data object. It's named underscore login result in this case, which is a live data for us that will be consumed by our listeners. And whenever our listeners will detect a state change, we will present to the user a failed or a successful login state. And what we are doing, we behind the scenes, like we already saw, we are only presenting a message with the user. So if we are checking here how we are enabling the biometric prompt, you can see it in this function. So we are using the biometric manager, and we are checking if we can authenticate, so if our device is able to authenticate us using biometric sensors. Then if we have a successful authentication, we will encrypt the information. And here we are using a cryptography manager and the cipher, and we are using those two to encrypt the information. So pretty easy to encrypt something, and also to protect the access of a certain portion of our application using the biometric prompts. Okay, so if we are getting back to the slides, another topic that we need to address is how we are performing a secure communication with another mobile device, let's say, or with a server. And we already know that in the last couple of years, all the major sites, HTTP sites, already converted their content to HTTPS. So they are using the secure socket layer to protect from middleman attacks, or to protect our exchange of information between the client and the server, to ensure that no one else can alter the request or the response. And here we can see how easily we can use the plain old URL connection to establish a connection to an HTTP site. We will take a 10-minute break, and after the break we will see how we can use SSL from our own applications to establish secure connections to servers. So 10-minute break. Okay, so we are back. Please do let me know if you have some questions or if something was unclear that we presented, or just provide some feedback if you are able to properly hear and see the screen. Thanks, Ruzvan. Any questions? Please feel free to interrupt and raise your questions if you have some. Okay, so like we were saying, we can use, if we are connecting from our mobile applications to an HTTP website, we can use the plain old URL connection to open a connection to that site. And we are getting an input stream and an output stream, and we can exchange information directly. That is true if we are using, let's say, some certificates that are recognized by the default store. If we have a custom one, and usually if we will build custom applications or applications that are connecting to some private servers, then we will need to use their certificates that are not public, let's say, or they are not registered at least with the default store. And here we can see how we can use the certificate API to register a custom one. So if we have in a file .crt the certificate, we can use the certificate factory to register and create to register that specified certificate in our key store. Okay, and we can register and then create a certificate to be used with SSL. So maybe if you used SSL in Java, you recognize that this is exactly the same process that we are using on normal Java applications to establish an SSL connection using a third-party certificate. And here you can see a sample site, the Washington EDU, that is providing a test page and a certificate that you can download and test your code using that certificate. Also on the server side, they can provide variations with non-secure and secure versions, like Gmail is doing. On our mobile application, when we are establishing an SSL connection, we can also check if the handshake, so the exchange of the information, the initialization of the exchange of the information, is performed using an SSL valid connection. So by using the verify and then a name of host with our socket session, we can ensure that we establish a proper connection. If not, we can trigger an exception. If the connection was made, after that point everything is encrypted and we can exchange normally connection data on that socket connection. Like I was mentioning at the beginning, a huge role our apps need to fill is the permissions details. So whenever we are trying to access something that's sensitive on the device, we need to request permissions from the user. And you'll see that a lot of calls, the calls that will get us sensitive information, require our application to have the permission provided by the user. And in order to gain access to sensitive information using an API like SMS, let's say here, we need to list that permission in the manifest file. So under the manifest XML entry, we need to use the user's permission XML tag and then list the actual permission that the system will provide from the user's point of view. So we need to be, the guidelines are saying that we need to be explicit. So we need to present to the user the reason why we need that permission enabled. Also, we need to be transparent. We need to present what we are doing with that data. And also, whenever we are using third-party libraries, we need to ensure that we understand what are the requirements of those libraries in terms of permissions. Before Android 6.0, whenever we were installing an app from the Play Store, we were getting a pop-up similar to the one presented on the screen with all the permissions that that app required. And that pop-up was built based on the manifest entries. And all of them were presented here once, and the user had to accept them all before installing the application. And in most of the cases, the users were confused why a certain application, like let's say an SMS application, need access to your camera, let's say, or why a camera app needs access to GPS locations. And by listing them all here and making a hard choice by requesting the user to accept them all, a lot of users were not willing to install certain apps because some permissions from here were not making sense for them. Okay, like let's say here for the Firefox browser, we may question why does it need access to our identity or to our app history or to our photos. So we from this pop-up, we are not able to grant certain permissions and to still install the application and to deny others. We had to accept all of them, and once we accepted them and installed the app, they were granted for life for that application. Okay, and this was viewed as a bad approach. And after Android 6.0, from the operating system settings, we can toggle on and off those permissions. For a browser, let's say for Chrome, we can switch off some of the permissions if we don't need them anymore. But this implies that our apps need to check the permissions at runtime. So we are not able to rely only on the manifest content. We still need to list them in the manifest file, but we need to check if the permission is available or not at runtime. And we will perform checks similar to what we have here presented. From the context, we will specify that we would like to access something camera related if we have the camera permission granted. Okay, because the users may turn off the access, and if we are not checking, the API call will break. We will perform the check, and if we have access, then we can do whatever we needed to do with the camera, let's say to grab the live feed or to grab a still image. But if we don't have permissions, then we can use the show request permission rationale call to request the permission from the user. And if we are using that call, a pop-up similar to the one presented here will request the user to enable the permission. And here we can customize the message. We can specify why do we need the permission, and that check, the never ask again, is part of the system. So if the user is performing that check and then pressing allow, that permission will be memorized for us by the system, and it will be always available. The vice versa is true as well. So if they are performing that never ask again check, then and denying, that will deny access to that feature from that moment on. Okay, so the system will assume that the user denied access to that call. So here we can see how using the requested permission API, we can check a bunch of permissions. So we can check an array of permissions altogether. And if we are using that call, everything is done asynchronous, because the user may, let's say, deny the access to it, or may spend a lot of time thinking about the permission. So everything is done asynchronous, and we will get a callback once the user is completing granting or denying the requested permissions, and we will get an array of permissions that were either granted or acknowledge, and we can check per permission what's happening, and we can make a decision based on the result. Here we listed the dangerous permissions, so the permissions that are considering dangerous from the point of view of the operating system, permissions for which we will need to request access. And you can see here that they are grouped by categories. They are related to calendar, to camera, to location, to phone. So we can request permissions to perform a call, or to read contacts, or to send SMS, or receive SMS, or to read the body of the SMS. We already saw the read external and write external storage permissions. So whenever we need to request information behind that category, we will need to use list that permission in the manifest file, and also request it at the runtime. Here we have also a demo, and we will switch to Android Studio, and we have a project named Runtime Permission Basics, where we are demoing some logic that is trying to access the camera using the permissions API. So let's deploy the app on the emulator. So what we have here is let's say an onboarding screen that will allow us to access the camera. And if we are accessing it for the first time, you'll see that we get an pop-up like this that will check. So this is in Android 11. They refactored a little bit the screen. Here we are presenting our custom message, and then we have some options. We may deny, we may grant the permission only one time, or while the app is using, while the app is used. So if we are granting only this time, the next time when we will access that functionality, the user will be prompted again to grant the permission. And as we can see here, we can interact with the camera, so we can move the phone from one side to another, and we may capture video or still images. So because we granted only one time, now that we are in the same session, we will be able to access again the camera. If we will restart the app, you'll see that we are so let's try it. We are stopping the app and starting it again. Theoretically, we should get again the permission message. I think the app in this case was reused, but so that's done by the operating system behind the scenes. Let's see in the properties what are the properties related to the app. So in properties, in apps and notification, if we are selecting all the apps, and here if we are searching for our runtime permission sample, we have a permissions tab here. And what was listed in the manifest file here as permissions will be listed here. And we can see that the ask every time camera is set. If we are acknowledging here and making that choice to always have the permission, it will be added here. And if we are denying it, it will be added in the denied section. So now to see how we are requesting the permission at runtime, we can see here how we are using the camera API. As you noticed, we are using a deprecated API, and this is because in Jetpack Compose they refactored the camera API, and now we have a newer version. But on the fields, most of the applications are still using the older one, so we need to know how to create and access the camera using the older API. It's pretty simple. We have a builder, and after that, with a camera ID, we can access a particular camera. Here, 0 means the camera which is on the back on of the phone. If you have more camera, you need to specify the ID that you'd like to access. And in the camera preview class, here when we are trying start preview, oh sorry, this is the camera preview. So here you can see how we are creating a surface where to render the content, and from the camera we are getting the surface from the camera to present. What I was trying to show here related to our demo is how we are requesting the permissions. Okay, so on our button, the camera button, here we are requesting the show preview of the camera, and we are using the check self API with the camera permission, and we are checking if we have that permission, we will start the camera and present that output in the surface that we created. If not, we are requesting the permission, and here you can see how using the pop-up we can customize what to present, And if the permission is granted, we will get the callback, and the callback is I think here. Yeah, it's right under the onCreate. Here, based on the result, if we are getting a granted permission, we are using a message here, we are listing, and then we are starting the camera. If not, we will say that the permission was denied. Okay, so you can check this application. And also we have two new projects that are using the newer API, Camera X Basic, and here you'll see a similar application that is using the newer API, so we should not have those camera deprecated messages anymore. Here we are using still a deprecated call. I didn't refactor yet the sample to allow the full screen for the app. So here you'll see that we are configuring, we have more capabilities to configure the camera, and I think in the fragments directory, in the fragments camera, here we are building the request. So here we are requesting, and here is how we are checking again for permissions. And we are using the navigation graph to move to a permissions fragment here, where we are doing the same thing that we saw on the previous sample. We are checking if we have permissions, then if we don't, we are requesting them. And if we do have permissions, then using the navigation graph, we are navigating to our camera fragment. So on sorry, not this one, on the camera fragment, this one, where we are interacting with the camera. And here you can see that we have a display manager, and here we are initializing the display manager using the bylazy Kotlin construct. That will mean that the display manager will be lazy loaded, so will be lazy initialized. So only when it is needed, then we will initialize it. In this callback, we are using a broadcast receiver. We will discuss more about broadcast receivers in a later lecture. Here the main functionality is that we are registering the volume down button as the shutter click for our camera. And here you can see how we are doing that. We have a callback to display the content that we have. Here we are doing some reinitialization on resume and on destroy view, because camera is an expensive object. We need to shut down the executor, so everything is done asynchronous, and we are using an executor, and we are shutting down the display manager and also the broadcast manager. We are unregistering them. On onCreate, here is the main body where we are, let's say, dealing with the camera. And here you can see how we are using a library named Glide to create thumbnails for the pictures that we are capturing. So whenever we are capturing a picture from the camera, we will create a thumbnail here for the gallery. And on the onViewCreate, here is the logic on where we are updating the content of the camera and how the content of the screen based on the camera, and how we are registering and initializing everything. The camera setup, maybe it's also important to present here, so we can specify all sorts of arguments now if we would like to have a switch between cameras button, so we can switch from one camera to another, from front to back. And using the newer API is much easier to handle all those cases. So please take a look at this sample as well, especially if you like to understand how to access camera using the newer API. Probably you already saw that we have an non-dangerous permission that we need to add in our manifest file named internet permission. So whenever we are trying to connect to an internet service or to a server, to something outside of our device, we will need that permission. Another topic that we need to address is the authentication one, and here we are advised to use OAuth2 because it's an industry standard and it's focused on creating a simple experience for us as developers when accessing third-party sites that are implementing OAuth. Most of the web applications are exposing their services using OAuth, and it's available on web application, desktop, mobiles, and all sorts of smart devices. Whenever we are trying to access a service using OAuth, we will use or need at least those two permissions, the account manager to be able to get access to users' credentials, and also the internet permission, the one that is not dangerous, like we mentioned before, that's needed to perform internet connections. To get an authentication token, we will use the account manager. So for this, we need the account permission. And here you can see how using the account manager and the get auth token call, we are specifying an account that we would like to be used when we are requesting the token, and some options. And the options here vary from service to service. So we may, some services are requiring us to specify in the options what's the task or the job that we would like to perform. And once we set those, we register a callback here that will be called if we are getting a successful token, and we will get the actual token there to use. That token will is a piece of information that should be used with the next calls to the service to authenticate us that we are the proper user that is performing the call. If we get a failure, we will get a callback on the on error callback. And here we can see how we are preparing a bundle on the on token acquired callback, we are receiving a bundle with the results, and we can check the bundle to extract the actual token, and in that string we will have the actual token to be used. If we are accessing a website like Google's API, let's say, to retrieve certain tasks that are available for us as a user, and we can use that @me to represent the connected user there with the API key, we will add in the HTTP headers a field named authorization, and the token will be appended to the OAuth keyword. And if we have a valid keyword, we will be able to retrieve the tasks. We have a demo here. It's not with tasks, is with a Google spreadsheet document. I think is this one. So Here, if we are running the application, you'll see that we have a button, connect. We will get some permissions here. We need permissions to access contacts, because in order to access a Google spreadsheet document, we need to provide contact information related to the user that is accessing it. So we will allow that access. Then we are prompted to select a user if we have more, or we would like to use a separate one. So this is part of the system authentication flow. So we are selecting our user. And after that, if everything is properly granted, we will get the content from the spreadsheet document. Here I listed a tutorial on how to enable the Google spreadsheet API for a particular application. Okay, thank you, Bogdan. I received that you are able to properly hear me. Thank you for that. So, like I was saying, we are provided here with a tutorial on how to enable the certificate for us. We will need to extract our key, the key that was used to sign this application, and register that key with the Google API website in order to get gain access there. Once we are performing those calls, those steps, we will be able to use the Google account credential manager from here to register and to gain access the services. But as we saw before connecting there, so when we are pressing the button, we need to ensure that we have certain permissions, and here are detailed the steps that we are performing to ensure that we are able to connect to Google services. So we are checking first if the Play Store services are available on the device. If not, we will prompt the user to update them, or to a message where it's saying that your phone is not able to connect to Google services. If that's available, then we are prompting the user to check or to supply an account. So using the choose account activity, we are checking if the user has a desired account to connect. Once that is done, we are checking if the device is online, and this is a call that you will need also to perform when you'll implement the network implementation variation of your app, to be able to detect if the mobile device is connected or not to the internet. And if we are not connecting, then we are printing an error message. And if all of those are granted and are available, then we can perform a background thread here to retrieve the information from the Google spreadsheet. And here we have a task, and it's pretty easy to retrieve information, because we are using a service, a library that made available for us by the Google team. So here you'll see that we have the Google API services, and those are making us available the Google Sheet API. And here we are specifying the credentials, how we would like to receive the information. So here we are registering a JSON factory to be able to unmarshal the information. We are specifying an application name here. That name was used when we registered our application to gain access to the spreadsheet document. This is the link to the document. And as you can see from the link that the browser is using, we are using only the the part that's highlighted here. So that's the key of the document, the ID of the document. But then we are specifying the actual name of the sheet in the document, and using the spreadsheet API, we can get a range of values here. And you can see that we are using a loop here to retrieve a bunch of information from the document, okay? And we are displaying them on the screen. Okay, if we are getting back to the slides, another topic that we need to address is an alternative to OAuth named JSON Web Token that's also an open standard that's used by some services. It's more compact than the OAuth. Also, it's using JSONs, like the name suggests. So it can be easily implemented by us as well as a server. Here we are presenting a scenario on how the JSON token framework is used. So if we have two parties here that are trying to exchange information, first of all we will perform an authentication with a login, that step that may perform a DB validation, and we will get a token similar to OAuth, and that token will be used in the next requests to authenticate us as the valid client. So usually, especially with bigger vendors, the authentication server is decoupled from the application server. So we will perform the authentication with a certain server that will return us the token, and after that, using that token, we will perform requests to the application server. This is ensuring that we can balance the requests, and we can use multiple application servers or multiple authentication services that are able to cope up with the huge load on a popular service. As a model, the header is pretty small, is having a type, the JSON token type, and an algorithm, an encryption algorithm, and then a payload. And usually here we will have information like this, an user with his ID or other fields. So everything is in the JSON format. And we are encrypting information something like this. So using an encoder, we will hash the data, and then using base 64 encoder with the hash data, we will create a signature for the request. We have a demo there as well. So here we have our portfolio app that we saw previously in our lectures, and on the GitHub we have a server directory as well. So on lecture 5 we have a server where we have a server in Go that is converted now to use JWT. So if we are starting the server and also the application, you'll see that we have almost the same functionality, I think exactly the same functionality that we had before. So we are presenting a list of portfolios, but first we need to authenticate. And here you'll see that we are performing an authentication first, and after that we are getting the list of portfolios. If you remember last time, we said that we are using retrofit behind the scenes. We are still using retrofit behind the scenes. So here we still have the retrofit server. Now we have, along with the get portfolios call, we have an get authentication call. And here you'll see that when we are creating the service, we are adding an interceptor. This one, the token interceptor, we are adding a logging one, the one from the library, the HTTP logging interceptor that is only logging the information in Logcat. And we are registering another interceptor that will detect if we have a token or not, and will automatically append the token for us. Other than that, we are still using the same retrofit logic. So using the builder, we are specifying the server URL, and that we would like to convert from JSON the information directly into our objects. And after that, we are registering our client. So if we are checking the token interceptor here, you'll see that the interceptor has a method named intercept, where we are checking if we have a post method call that is containing in the URL the token out call, then we will proceed and retrieve the token. If not, we will append as a header the authentication field, and we will add the token that was received for us. And here we have some services that are pushing the login credentials to authenticate us. In the activities, when we are displaying the portfolios, we still have the same logic, so we didn't change anything here, because everything was done behind the scenes for us by the retrofit call and that interceptor. So here you'll see that when we are performing the authentication call using the authenticate method from the API, we are receiving that token, and that token will be set to the interceptor. And from that point on, retrofit will take care of all the calls to sign them with the token. We have also a Flutter application that is using the same server to retrieve the portfolios. So here in the main, if we are starting and deploying the app in a couple of seconds, we will see hopefully the app running. While the app is running, let's see here, someone in a later in an earlier lecture asked if we will review the block pattern. So here we are using the block pattern, and behind the scenes, block pattern is similar to a live data object. So it's still an observable object. Here we are using a library that's hiding a lot of implementation details for us. And maybe that's useful, because at the end of the day, we are left with two things: the subject that we are watching, so in the observable pattern, and also a stream that will collect everything that the block object is receiving. So here we have getPortfolios method that will try to fetch all the portfolios, and once it will get a response from the server, so we are using a sync call here. Once we will get the response, we will use the sync method to push the new portfolios into the subject. And we have a dispose method here to clear everything. In our application here, you can see that we have an auth button here that is triggering the authentication call, and after that is performing the get operation. And if we are checking the authentication call from here, we are performing a simple HTTP call, so we are preparing the data to send to the server, and you can see here the username and the password that we are sending, and the headers that we are sending to the token auth endpoint. And based on the response, if we have a 200, so a successful response, we are decoding the token and we are returning it, in this case, to be used by the other calls. So when we are fetching something like portfolios here using the slash p endpoint, you can see that in the headers we are adding the token using the bearer header as well. And if everything is successful, we will get a response that we are decoding and we are presenting the list of portfolios on the screen. If not, we will trigger an error. So here let's ensure that we still have the server running, and if we are pressing the auth call, you'll see that we are performing the authentication and then we are retrieving the portfolios. Like I said, the server right now is written in Go, and you can check the sources to see how we implemented it. In a later lecture, we will present a variation in Node.js as well. So if you are more familiar with Node, you can use that one as well. But right now we are using Go for this implementation. So today we discussed about the API that's available for us to encrypt and decrypt user sensitive information, how we can use permissions to establish that we are acting on behalf of the user, and how to use OAuth and JSON Web Toolkit. So now if you have some questions, please point them out. I see that we have already one question here. So Bogdan is asking if it's a good place to store the token on the client side in order to not authenticate again after closing the app. It depends. So Bogdan, it depends on the server implementation. Usually the tokens are valid only for a couple of hours. And you'll see that most of the APIs are having callbacks to re-register the token, to receive the newer token. We will see when we will discuss about notifications from Firebase, let's say. There we will see that they are using the same mechanism and the token will be refreshed for us. So it depends on the server. Anyway, if you are planning to store the token, I suggest you to use settings for that, and encrypted settings, as we saw today. So a good question, Bogdan. Hopefully you were able to understand what I was saying. You're welcome. Anyone else? Any other questions? If not, we will end the lecture here, and we will continue the discussion on laboratories. I hope that you enjoyed this lecture, and you'll secure your applications. Take care. Bye.